All right, so we're gonna change completely gears from techniques and experimental methods. We're gonna jump to another model. We are talking broadly about the statistical models and mechanistic models. We're gonna go into the animal models, another experimental model we can ask questions to, and the one where you definitely need to reflect really before a lot, because you cannot simply close your computer, restart it again to run again your simulation. In the animal model, you need to reflect really well what you're gonna try to do, and because you have one try, two tries, and that's all. So it's my pleasure to introduce you to Professor Fritz Prinsen, who is one of the brightest minds in this area. I have greatly enjoyed discussions with him, trying to drive those complementarities between mechanistics, mechanistic modeling and animal modeling. And he's one of the professors in our Personalized in Silico Consortium, that is one of the projects supporting also this summer school. And I'm sure that if you open your mind to learn what is science like in another arena that you're not used to, you're gonna learn a lot and enjoy the talk. So over to you, Fritz.
So thank you, Pablo. I don't know whether you invited me to come here, but it has probably at least passed through you. I hope I'm not gonna disappoint you too much that I don't talk only about animal experiments. But I think the title is in that sense clear, is that the bedside is that the bench is animal models, the bedside obviously is the patient, and the bits are the computer models. So, and that's really, I mean, my core business is animal experiments, true, but I see it in very tight connection with the other things. I'm gonna talk about cardiac resynchronization therapy. And my approach, and one of my main messages is also, I mean, a little bit provocative after the previous talk, is which was all about machine learning for imaging, that from my perspective, I'm a physiologist, that imaging is the last thing you need in modeling. The first thing is to put physiology into the equations and not the shape. The shape is secondary. Okay, of course, it's not entirely true, but at least to wake you up. So it's part of what I'm gonna talk is in this article which appeared recently again, and you see by the triangle that you need to see the three things in connection with each other, and some of the publications I'm gonna discuss with you are indeed examples where we are able to publish computer simulations in connection with animal experiments or clinical data. So this is what I'm gonna do, is to discuss the problem of desynchrony in heart failure. I know many of you are into cardiac research. I know some of you are not, so I'm trying to take you with me as good as possible. And then the question, how can the bits contribute to bedside? And this is from a point of view that this is VPH, this is the virtual physiological human. I'd like to stress that part. And the bits can contribute in, for example, understanding the mechanism of the therapy of CRT, cardiac resynchronization therapy. How does it work? Also, how can we select the patients for the therapy better? And how can we actually apply better therapy? And so emphasis will be on better biomarkers, which we may have, because we can, the clinicians can think of a lot of biomarkers they can measure on the patients, which predict the outcome of the patients. But maybe the computer models can help to find these better biomarkers. And also, a very interesting aspect, I think, is that we are now have better view, thanks to the model, of the role of the right ventricle. And the right ventricle is kind of the unknown ventricle. We all think about the heart as the left ventricle, the big pump, which pumps the blood into our circulation. And we really a lot forget about the right ventricle. It's a little bit, if you think in the gender issue, it's like the female of the two ventricles. Females are a lot underappreciated, underpaid as well, and so on. So, and they are just as valuable, we cannot do without the two genders, and also not, certainly not without the right ventricle. So that's kind of the agenda. So first, for to bring everybody at the same level, talk about heart failure, because that's why we're going to talk about. There are many patients in the world, and most numbers are available for the United States, but Europe is about the same. There are millions of people with heart failure. There are many new cases each year, and the mortality is high. I mean, compared to many types of cancer, the mortality is higher in heart failure. Once you are diagnosed with heart failure, 50% dies within 5 years. So that's pretty severe disease in that case. Of course, we used it for selling our projects to all kind of funding agencies, but it's still, it's true. And for our field, it's important to recognize, of course, we have a lot of drugs treating heart failure, not as good as we would hope, but 30% of all heart failure patients have particular derangements in the conduction of the ventricles, creating ventricular disynchrony. And disynchrony means not simultaneous contraction of the different parts of the heart. And that's the one we may treat. And I explain you these activation patterns. This is a longitudinal section through the heart with the atria on top and the ventricles on the bottom. And activation starts in the sinus node. It spreads over the atria. It comes in a rapid conduction system in the ventricle. And the two ventricles are activated fairly simultaneously. Considering the large size of the ventricles, it's done in 80 milliseconds. That's pretty smartly designed system, actually. And the problem is that in some cases, not all 30% of heart failure patients have a left bundle branch block, but 20% have. And there, the left bundle, which is, you see, broken, the conduction only passes by through the right ventricle, and then the rest of the conduction has to be done through the regular myocardium. And that's just twice as slow. So this is a dysynchronous conduction, so the activation reaches the left ventricular wall pretty late. And you can say, I don't care, because still the conduction is going, the electrical impulse is gone everywhere. But if you then measure the contraction patterns, you see there's something going on. On top you see actually, you see 3D, it's a model, but it's based on measurements with a lot of electrodes, in this case canine heart. So this is what we did with a lot of electrodes around the heart and inside the heart. This is some the strengths of animal models still, and that if you treat them well, you can do a lot of detailed measurements and you learn a lot about activation. The color is the activation time. Red is early, and so you see activation spreads from here to there, but there's no time differences here, but this is like 50 milliseconds, the latest region is activated. This is the left bundle branch block, and now only the right ventricle, a piece of the right ventricle, is activated early, and the activation spreads very slowly in double the time it reaches the left ventricle over here. And here are measurements of strain, which is the length change during contraction. So, as it's mentioned here, downward is shortening, that's what you want. And in a normal heart, after activation at time zero, all the fibers are shortening, and the green and the red area over here and there, they behave pretty much the same, a nice coordinated contraction. This is what happens if in this situation. And you see, just briefly look at it, it's a wild pattern. It's completely disorganized system, and this is not very good. And really the first time I saw these kind of measurements with a very old-fashioned technique 30 years ago, we sat together with colleagues because we didn't understand. Why is this happening with such a simple thing as disturbing the electrical conduction in the heart? Why is it giving us this wild pattern of activation? And then after a while, we thought, okay, this is what's happening. The green one is the region with the early activation. And yes, it's not so hard to understand that if the electrical impulse comes in a region then it starts the contraction. That's what every muscle, also skeletal muscles, you need the electrical impulse, then you get contraction. And if you think of the ventricle as a balloon, if one part contracts, the other part may be stretched. And that's what we see here. The remote region is being stretched by the early contracting regions. And now the more complicated phase comes, because now you see that this red line goes very deep, deeper than it did before. And that's because this red region was pre-stretched. And we know in physiology, and this is an important mechanism in muscles, also skeletal muscles, that the longer the muscle fiber is, the stronger it gets. That's why if you're throwing a ball, you first go back to stretch your muscle to throw. Or if you want to jump, you first bend your knees and then you jump, because your upper leg muscles are being stretched and they become more powerful. The same is in the heart with this mechanism. And you see there's a prolonged and forced shortening of this red region, but because that region is now so strong, it kicks out the green region. So that's why this biphasic pattern occurs in the green region, and what we call rebound stretch. And altogether, you see these regions are working against each other, which not makes a very efficient contraction. And this is somebody else's study where they used pacemakers. If you do a right ventricular pacemaker, you also create this kind of left bundle branch block-like behavior. And what you can see is that immediately after a normal activation, this is the pump function expressed as ejection fraction for those who are into the field. So this is a good ejection fraction. Immediately upon starting this desynchronous activation, you lose like 6% points of your ejection fraction. But now the second thing happens is not only that discoordination, which is bad, if it continues, this desynchrony, even a week, you lose another 6% points. So then suddenly you're looking at a pretty serious reduction in pump function. And you see, so there's also tissue adaptations come into play here. Yeah? And these adaptations are not good, they are actually bad, because things get worse. And to prove that same principle, you can turn off the pacemaker to a normal atrial pacemaker, you get an immediate jump of a few percent, and then you need another 1 or 2 weeks to recover fully from this. So the whole picture, very briefly, is that if you start here with a desynchronous electrical activation, you start a large number of processes and vicious circles around structure, around metabolism, neurohumoral activation, hormones getting produced, actually all going down to the center, making things worse, worsening function, bringing the patient or the heart at risk for arrhythmia. And so it's really a serious situation. Now, happily, there is a therapy for this around 20 years from now. And this is the CRT, which uses a pacemaker with an electrode in the right atrium near the sinus node. It picks up the electrical activation, so it knows now when the sinus node fires, so it knows the heart rate. It brings that signal to the pacemaker, and then that pacemaker, with a certain delay, gives the impulses to two electrodes, one on the right ventricle here and one on the left ventricle there. And then this helps to resynchronize the two ventricles. And the beauty of this 20 years ago was that this is just a slight modification of an old-fashioned pacemaker, which is 60 years old, where there was only one electrode or two electrodes, one in the atrium and one in the right ventricle. So the engineers of the companies only needed to add one more electrode, and they had a whole new therapy for heart failure. And importantly, as you see here, which comes back in my talk, this pacemaker, you can implant those electrodes, but you can also program the delay between pacing these atrial and right ventricular and left ventricular electrode. And this is part of optimizing the therapy, and I will show you some data. Yeah, so very simplistically, I showed you these activation patterns. And now, again, in the animal experiment, if you pace from the two electrodes on the right and the left, this is what your activation pattern is. You see, it's much better than it is here. All the blue has gone. It's still not as good as the really normal heart, but that's really hard to beat the natural conduction system. But still, this is much better than it was. And how good it is shown by a lot of large clinical trials. This is one of the big ones, where this is a randomized study. So patients, in this case, get an implantable defibrillator. In this case, this control group only protecting against arrhythmia. And in this case, the patient got an ICD together with this resynchronization capacities. And you see this is the survival without heart failure. So it's a combined endpoint. And you see that the number of people either dying or getting heart failure is 30%, 34% less in this case. So this is quite a considerable effect in patients with heart failure. So that's why it's being used. I think nowadays, I think at each year, at least 50,000 patients in Europe get such an IC, such a CRT pacemaker. So it's a very widely used system. Experts say that's still not enough. We can do much more because still a lot of cardiologists and doctors don't know about the system, but already it is a very successful therapy. However, things are not as simple as that. And this is shown by this small study from a colleague, Mark Strick, who did his work in Bordeaux, where he took a group of 26 patients and he measured hemodynamic pump function. And this is zero, and this shows the hemodynamic benefit of biventricular pacing. And if you just follow the red dots, these few patients here, so he arranged them based on the hemodynamic effect. So these are the worst patients. They actually get worse. Four patients actually worsen their pump function. A number of patients show very, well, no effect here or a very mild effect. And then there are patients showing a very clear effect. So it's not like, on average, it's a good therapy, but at the individual basis, it's not as good. And you want to understand why. Now, there are two aspects of these patients which are very clear and which give you already some information. These are the pluses are the patients with SCAR, so an old infarction. And you see most of the poorly responding patients had SCAR, not all of them. And also, most of the poorly responding patients had no left bundle branch block, so the, say, beautiful conduction abnormality. They had like milder conduction abnormalities. So they, two of them explain some of these differences, but as you see, not all of them. So you need to better understand it, this, you may want to look at a computer program. And in the CRT business, this is the puzzle we are looking at, is can we understand this, basically? And this is important to realize that with CRT, we are influencing the electrical tissue properties, but not the mechanical. But obviously, you by electrical stimulation, you influence the timing of contraction, but you don't change the tissue properties mechanically. And somehow, together, they have to collaborate to improve pump function. And so there are a lot of factors contributing potentially to the CRT effect. I showed you already an indication that SCAR is important, and that's also, of course, logical. The conduction disorder, so left bundle branch block or not. You may improve the effect by better programming the device, AV, the atrioventricular and the ventricular delays. I will talk to that later. To what extent myocardial stretch is involved is an issue which I'm going to show you, and also the interaction between the two ventricles. And of course, the positioning of the pacing lead, and there's still maybe pieces of the puzzle missing. And computer modeling, well, you all know about this, is important, and you can do a lot with it. And the ideal tissue, the computer model would look like this, where I showed you the activation patterns from animal experiments, and you might be able to reproduce this in the model. And this would be composed of many cells and a conduction and conduction velocity and even a rapid conduction system. And at the cellular level, also the ion channels, all of them here, and connecting with calcium to the contraction model and actin-myosin interaction to force development to contraction of both ventricles and then pumping out the blood here through the resistances of the valves and the peripheral circulation. So this all would be the complete modeling of all heart function. And to do this even more properly, you want to have shapes of the heart in different fashions, and there are around from rabbit, from swine, rabbits again, canines, and also, and Hopkins, human model of this shape. And even more ideally, you want to have the fiber orientation in the heart, the sheets of the fibers, which are also important, and then other parts where you also want to have scar and location and size and how the tissue around the scar would behave. This is a hell of a job, and it's very complicated. It's actually very hard also to connect all these elements together, and of course it's computationally very expensive. And that's what I mentioned in the beginning. In Maastricht, we started modeling of the heart 40 years ago, and with Theo Arts is the primary investigator in that sense. And his approach, and so I'm only saying his idea, is that a model should be as simple as possible, but not simpler. So start very simple and then add elements to that based on the research question you ask. And I'm showing you some examples how this would be helpful. And the model I'm talking about is the CircAdapt lump parameter model of the heart and the circulation. And beside Theo Arts, nowadays Joost Lumens is the investigator who is bringing this into, say, more clinical practice. And the CircAdapt model is considering has a few important elements. It uses the closed circulation, and so the complete circulation to the lungs and to the body, with the right and the left ventricle. It considers the two ventricles, and importantly also the interaction between the two ventricles through this interventricular septum. And it considers the properties of the myofibers in the tissue. And of course, there are some basic elements like mechanical force equilibrium, that if the right ventricle pulls or pushes harder on these hinges here, it has also effects on the left ventricle. There's conservation of energy. All the work done by the ventricles is being transported to the aorta, to the circulation. And very importantly, again here, is the length-dependent activation, which is also known as the Frank-Starling mechanism. And in the model, it's actually done in a phenomenological way. That is that if we say that at a certain point a region is activated, we get a twitch contraction, which looks like this, over time. And then this, the force and the duration is dependent on the sarcomere length, so on the length of the muscle fiber. So the shorter the muscle fiber is, the weaker and the shorter the contraction is. And this is based on experimental data. And you see how important this sarcomere length is, because it's definitely increasing the force and the duration significantly. So this is how you can look at the model nowadays. There are the two ventricles. This is called the TRISAC module, where the two ventricles are in parallel connection to each other. There are also atria, which are other chambers which can contract. And we have, of course, the outflow through valves and resistances to here the pulmonary circulation and back here to the systemic circulation. One step further, we made, in order to be more precise, is to divide both the right ventricular and the septal wall and the left ventricular free wall into patches, which we can then give certain properties, both structurally and also electrically. So in this case, this is where we measured electrical data from patients, And this is the bullseye representation with the apex in the middle, but we can translate it into activation patterns like this. So this is the synchronous activation or almost synchronous activation. And then we can create, right apex or left bundle branch block situation with an early activated right ventricle and a late activated left ventricle. And we can do the reverse. Then we paste from the left ventricle and this is late. And you see the assumption with these patches is that all these patches in each of the walls, they share the same tension and radius of curvature. That's an assumption. It's a simplification. But altogether, in this way, it makes life a lot easier. It's a very clear assumption. We have some publication that it's not doing so bad, actually. And what I would like to discuss with you is how we use this model to solve a question of doctors. Because, as I told you, the CRT is a great therapy for the average person in a certain category. But within the cardiology, you have electrophysiologists, EP doctors, and you have heart failure doctors. Heart failure doctors look at echocardiograms, so the mechanical consequence of the heart, and the electrophysiologists look at the ECG. And I always say to a cardiologist, well, if I come with my car to a garage and want to repair, every engineer is capable to handle both the valves of my engine and the electrical ignition. So they are electromechanical engineers. In cardiologists, the ECG is read by one and the echo is read by another cardiologist, and they hardly talk to each other. Yeah? So this is the stupid thing. This is already the first advantage we can get from a combined model, if even it's very simple, because now we can translate the story of the two kind of cardiologists. Okay. So this is the story that the electrocardiologists look at the ECG, which is the QRS complex here, and they look at the width of this QRS complex. And they say, well, this is a wide QRS complex. This is a good patient. The heart failure doctors look at time to peak shortening based on echo. So this is the shortening peak in one wall of the heart, and this is the shortening peak on the other side. And so they say, oh, this is a long distance between the two peaks, so this is a good patient. Now, there have been a lot of trials showing that the ECG is actually fairly good. There have been disappointing trials showing that the echo is actually not so good. That the time to peak, if they identify patients like that, they didn't respond so well to the therapy. And everybody was wondering why. And so this is what Joos Lumens did some 7-8 years ago, is just simply in the circuit depth model, use the model, first of all, in the synchronous activation, and you get the strains like you see in a normal heart, and in the two walls of the heart, so the septum and the free wall, you find the simultaneous contraction, and then you can really increase the delay between the two walls by 20, 40, 60, 80, and 100 milliseconds. And you can see that indeed the shortening pattern is sensitive to the timing, and that indeed by 20 milliseconds delay, the early activated region also has an earlier peak contraction. So far, so good. Interestingly, if you go to 40 milliseconds, this time difference doesn't change so much. But then certainly at 60 milliseconds, the peak shortening is now much earlier, like 200 milliseconds earlier, rather than this 90 milliseconds which we had here. So suddenly between 40 and 60, you're suddenly looking at an extra step of 200. And whatever you do after that, it stays at 200. So you see that because of this behavior of the walls and effectively the interaction between the walls, the peak shortening time is only at best a semi-quantitative expression of the real activation delay. So this is an explanation where now a lot of people believe in that peak time to peak shortening is a poor indicator of the true desynchrony. Well, there's another thing, and this is to the question, so what should we measure then on the echo in order to do good things? And this is the next study. And first of all, this is an extension of the previous one. This is the representation of the cross section of the left ventricle with the six sectors which echocardiographers usually recognize, represented by the colors. And so in the circuit depth model, he started with a synchronous activation and the strain in the six sectors, which you see is pretty similar. Now the peak, the upward peak is the peak shortening because this is actually radial strain or wall thickening. And if you then gradually increase the amount of electrical desynchrony, you see that the strain patterns become crazier and crazier. This is really a wild discoordination between the two regions. Now, the other source of mechanical desynchrony may also be, and this has been thought, maybe non-electrical substrate, so SCAR, old infarction. So he said, well, let's also simulate SCAR in all situations. So in the synchronous electrical activation, mild SCAR or severe SCAR, and you see this also has an effect on the strain patterns, but you see this pattern is different from this pattern, clearly. And then you can also, in the model, combine the two. You can combine electrical desynchrony with SCAR desynchrony. And you see a whole collection of strain patterns which is too complicated maybe to grasp. And so, well, first of all, what has been tested now in this situation where you see all kind of conditions, then to apply biventricular pacing and see how much improvement is being obtained. And this is the increase in stroke volume if you do biventricular pacing in this model. Well, obviously, if you are synchronous, you're not going to improve. Actually, you lose a little bit of stroke volume, and all these hearts lose stroke volume. And the more you go to the right, you see that the stroke volume is good. And interestingly, you get a pretty significant increase in stroke volume also in the heart with big SCAR. So it's only, or almost only, the electrical asynchrony which gives you, which is requested to get a good response of this therapy. So now, what pattern, because we see all these wild patterns, what pattern now can we get out of it to predict which patient, which of these conditions is responding to the therapy? And after a search, and this is one example again from a very asynchronous heart, with some analysis, he found out that this is the way to go, that these are, this is like taking an average of this one, and then you can combine to make life a little bit easier and more robust to, let's see, this is the septum is the yellow and the red, and the lateral wall is the green and the purple. So if you just take the average of those two opposite walls, it's either the early stretch of the late activated region of the left ventricular free wall, or the rebound stretch of the septum, but in both cases stretch, which is always bad in systole. If you add these two together, then this gives you the systolic stretch index, and this is a predictor. And this was, in his model, the best strain predictor of CRT response. And now came, of course, the proving of the pudding. And then he got data from John Gorshin from the United States from a group of 191 CRT patients, and their response was known. Here the endpoint is hospitalization for heart failure or death, and you see the patients with a high SSI did much and much better than with low SSI. This is actually only really what we call the very hard endpoint, death, heart transplant or assist device, same separation. And also interesting, these were all patients, these were the patients with a non-left bundle branch block. So with the borderline patients, still the SSI was able to separate the two categories pretty well. So from what we learned from this one, this study is that time to peak strain measurements provide unreliable values of the synchrony, and that instead a new biomarker from echo may be derived, which is the SSI, and that's now under further investigation. Maybe stop. Are there any questions so far? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. So just to repeat your question so that everybody hears it, do we know whether the location of the scar matters? And the answer is, well, that's exactly where we need imaging and the real anatomy, because that part of the anatomy is not into the model. So we cannot, this is the limitation of CircAdapt. And I'm really eager to collaborate with anybody on that part and that question. Yeah, and that's certainly of interest. Yeah, but it looks at least that the mere presence of scar is already important. But we really want to have a further step, for which we need another model. Yeah, definitely. So the other thing I mentioned already is that most of the studies in cardiology in general and also in CRT are only looking at the left ventricle. And is this correct? And I'm gonna the answer is of course no. And I'm gonna address this with two research topics. First of all, why is the effect of biventricular pacing, so the right and the left ventricle, the same as for pacing only the left ventricle? And the second is, it addresses also how to tune the pacing intervals. And in both cases, the right ventricle is going to be important. So this is actually a question, why is there the same response to left ventricular and biventricular pacing, which has been there from the very beginning of CRT. So this is measurements in Bordeaux, in this case, from using ECG imaging. So that's a technique where you have 200 electrodes around the chest, and together with the knowledge of the anatomy and a computer model, you can calculate the activation pattern of the heart. Okay. This is the activation pattern in a patient with left bundle branch block. So early right ventricular activation going around to the left ventricle, and here this is a late left ventricular activation. So this is very dissynchronous activation. If you pace the left ventricle, you kind of flip the activation pattern. Now the left ventricle is early and the right ventricle is late. And with biventricular pacing, as I suggested already in the beginning, you get a more synchronous activation like you see here. So this electrically, this is clearly the better pattern. But already small studies showed that actually in pump function terms, LV pacing is just as good as BIV pacing. And I didn't really understand 25 years ago, and many other people, and they said, yeah, but it's always good to have this extra right ventricular lead as well, because this is still better. And this whole question was actually most clearly shown by this study from Canada 8 years ago, where they did a crossover study in patients, giving them 6 months of left ventricular pacing and 6 months of biventricular pacing, or the other way around. And what you see is that compared to their baseline, yes, you get a significant increase in ejection fraction, so pump function, but the same in LV and BIV pacing. You look over 6 months, the heart gets smaller, which is good, but equally good for left and biventricular pacing. And I let them exercise, and the increase in exercise time is just as good in LV and BIV pacing. So it shows that although the electrical pattern is completely different, the functional effect is the same. Okay, so more interestingly, we did the same in Maastricht with the animal experiments. So these are patients from Bordeaux. These are dogs in Maastricht. We looked at the hemodynamic response, and we see indeed exactly the same. It doesn't matter in terms of DPDT, which is a matter of the contractility of the heart. It doesn't matter whether you do LV or BIV pacing. Whereas if you look at the electrical activation and the amount of resynchronization, sorry, electrical activation time, so downward is resynchronization, both in the patients and in the dogs, although there's a little difference in quantitative difference, but both biventricular pacing, you get better electrical activation. In LV pacing, you actually get slightly worse. So I sat down with Joost Lumens, and he said, well, yeah, you know, but these patient studies are always a bit lousy. And then with the dogs, it was a bit more complicated because I think we always start with healthy dogs. But he still said, well, there's something wrong with the measurements. So he said, let's go for simulations, because now we are going to understand this. So in the CircuitAdapt model, as you see here, this is activation, and we program activation as you would see in a left bundle branch block situation, early right ventricle, relatively early septum, late left ventricle, and with LV pacing you get the opposite activation pattern, and this is what you get with BiV pacing, according to the measurements in the patients. And in order to simulate the patients, contractility of the elements was reduced. And so you get a heart with indeed an ejection fraction in the model of 26%. So really similar to the patients. And then he showed that also in CircuitAdapt, it doesn't matter whether you do LV or BiV pacing. And now he didn't understand that at all, because he said, I know exactly what I'm doing. There's nothing wrong with my model, he said. And still I get a similar output despite the difference in electrical activation. How is this possible? And it's only after a while that he will start looking at the work, at the myofiber work. And the fiber work is the integral of strain and force development. And what we knew already is that in the early activated regions, there's low amount of work. So the septum performs low work, the left ventricular free wall actually performs a lot of work. And if you reverse the pattern with LV pacing, which we also know new for 20 years, is that now this is the low work region and the high work region. And that with BiV pacing, you get a more nicely, it's not completely perfect, but nicer distributed work distribution. So far there's no surprise. The surprise was when we looked at the right ventricle, because here in LV pacing, you see that the work is higher. And this is because the LV pacing is not only stretching the septum, but also the right ventricular wall. That's what we could see in the strain pattern, which I save, which I don't show now. But the strain patterns here in the right ventricular free wall were also abnormal, pre-stretching, and then increasing the work. So if we now make a sum of all the work of all the myofibers together, you see that the total amount of work by all the myofibers, again, is the same in LV pacing and BiV pacing, but now more work, the gain in LV pacing, is by the increase in the right ventricle. So it shows that the right ventricle in this case supports the left ventricle. A nice collaboration between the two ventricles. Whereas in the BiV pacing situation, the most of the gain is just in the left ventricle. So you have a different mechanism of hemodynamic improvement, but still having ultimately the same effect. So this was real, and this really shows that what we say here, this is the parallel arrangement of the two ventricles with the septum in between, and actually also probably forces acting at the connection between the right and the left ventricle. Together, they may make the heart stronger if you now stimulate the right ventricle. So this is the parallel arrangement of the two ventricles. You probably need a healthy right ventricle for this, so this is what we need to investigate and may be interesting for a next study in patients as well, but this is what it learned, and this was also in the field an interesting, a little shock in the field, I would say. So the final part is the question how to best tune the delays in the BiV pacing, and this is a repetition of the picture I showed you before. And so normally you would say I activate both ventricles at the same time, but pacemaker companies added the option to play with those timing delays. And so there's been some indications that it does matter, but really to understand why is not very clear. And so to better understand this problem, we first did animal experiments. So these are dogs. We created heart block here, and with a very complicated setup, where we have a lot of electrodes around the heart, all these dots here, where we put pressure catheters in the right and the left ventricle, also septal electrodes in the heart. So a lot of tools to do the measurements. And we ran a protocol which was pretty complicated because we varied the delay between the atrial sensing and the right ventricle from 50 to 230 milliseconds, and the same for the left ventricle. So you have a 10 by 10 matrix of delays, so altogether 100 different situations. So this is, you can and this was done in a random fashion, so it's a very complicated experimental model where we measured the activation time at baseline and during all conditions, so the electrograms from all these electrodes, and we measured the DPDT, so the contractility in the left ventricle, in the right ventricle, also at this baseline, at any delay you can imagine. And in this case, you see here already an interesting situation that when this moving from this situation to that one, you get a slight increase in the left ventricle, but you see a significant decrease in the right ventricle. And this, of course, is interesting. Now, to model that more properly, what we did is we took all the electrical maps from all the different situations, and you see some examples here, and we used that data to put those activation times of the right and the left ventricle in the circuit depth model. And this is an example of biventricular pacing. So this is what we call now a dog-specific version of circuit depth. And from there, we simulated our experimental protocol and first of all looked whether the results of the model, the computer model, was the same as in the animals, and secondly, better understand what we found. And this is a bit of a complicated slide in a way, because this is showing exactly the matrix, and we looked at two different directions, purely increasing the delay between atrium and the two ventricles, so a bit equal activation, 50-50, 70-70, 90-90 of the right and the left ventricle, so you go along the red line here, or where you actually change perpendicular to the direction. This is a situation with the LV at 50 milliseconds and the right ventricle paced at 210, so this is basically a left ventricular pacing situation, and you go perpendicular to a situation where now here the right ventricle is pre-excited and the left is very late. And this is the more interesting part, so I would like to go especially in the green direction, which is shown here on the right here. And the dots here are the simulation data, and the green are the means and standard deviations of or standard errors of the measurements. So you see there's not perfect overlap, but at least there's quite some similarity. And what you see basically is that, have to look at the x-axis here. So this is the left ventricular delay of 50 and a right ventricular delay of 210. So this is a very early excited left ventricle with a late excited right. And we move slowly to a late left ventricle and early right ventricle. What you see is that earlier the left ventricle is activated, more or less, the larger the effect is on the left ventricle and the better the effect on the left is, but the worse the effect on the right ventricle. And the other way around, the earlier the right ventricle, the better the response and the worse the left. So we have a problem now that we have to want to, we need to choose between the right and the left ventricle. What is the best now for the circulation? Because we are looking at contractility of the two ventricles, but ultimately the body is interested into the cardiac output, into the liters of minutes delivered by the heart. And because the two ventricles are in series, if the right ventricle doesn't pump out to the left cannot pump out to the body. So you need both to be performed equal. And so we, in a model, we then looked at the response and over time as well, where we see here the change of DPDT, From baseline, these are different individual heartbeats, if you will, at least in the model. Oh. And this is what you see. In the situation where you early activate the left ventricle, you get a beat by beat, and this is what you see in animals and patients as well, an immediate increase in DPDT in the left ventricle, but a decrease in the right ventricle. So the right ventricle gets weaker by early activation of the left ventricle. But the consequence of that is that the stroke volume is also lower in the right ventricle. It's getting better in the left, but worse in the right, because the ventricle is weaker. But because of that, the right ventricle doesn't pump out all the blood, and the next heartbeat, the volume in the right ventricle, the end-diastolic volume, is larger. And because that volume is larger, we again have this effect of the Frank-Starling mechanism of the length-dependent activation. The longer the fibers are, the larger volume is the same as longer fibers, the larger end-diastolic volume increases the stroke volume again, basically to what it was, despite the lower contractility. So it's another effect of the end-diastolic volume. And because the right ventricle here pumped out less blood to the left ventricle, the end-diastolic volume of the left was smaller, and therefore the stroke volume dropped. And the basic effect and the collaboration of these two factors, contractility and end-diastolic volume, together after a number of heartbeats, brings you to a new equilibrium, which is still better than baseline, but not as much as you would anticipate from the left, but not as bad as you would anticipate from the right. And I think this is the ultimate solution, that measuring stroke volume or something equivalent to that is the ultimate goal. And interestingly, a lot of investigators, including myself, are measuring DPDT. So that's not ideal, maybe. And that you see that in all different situations, you see this equilibrium exist. And that if you compare all the situations, this situation with very short delays of both the right and the left ventricle gives you the best stroke volume increase in the situation. So, concluding from all this work, a physiologically strong and geometrically simple lump parameter model already can provide important information about mechanisms of CRT. And it can be used to design new mechanical biomarkers, and therefore precise information about geometry and anatomy may not be needed for assessing first order effect. I showed you already, I discussed already, that knowing about the anterior and posterior wall is not known. I say that's like a second order effect. But having this, we significantly simplify the simulations. You have to realize that all these simulations run almost real time. So every second you have a new heartbeat, allowing to investigate multiple heartbeats, and therefore is very useful. I can continue to some future perspectives, but I maybe allow some time for discussion because of time.
We are already minute 55 of the 60 minutes allocated. Okay. So do we have questions, comments, or otherwise we can provoke those discussions on the fly?
Cristobal.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for the talk, very interesting. So for VIVI pacing, we know that one of the crucial elements is the position of the LV lead, the LV electrode. So now that you are showing the importance of the right ventricle in these models and the effect of LV pacing versus VIVI pacing, do you think that the position of the RV electrode is also crucial, or as crucial as the LV electrode?
Well, again, that's I think the same answer as I gave earlier, that very precise location effects, you need a more precise finite element model or something like that. We cannot answer that from CircuitAdapt. Mm-hmm. No. We have some studies done on the distance between the scar and the LV electrode, but it's a very superficial one. So that already gives some information, but where in the right ventricle or where in the left ventricle, that's something to be done. Other, if we know the amount of the pattern of activation, or whether it's better to go on a better position in the left or the right, that those numbers can be used in circuit depth, but not the conduction of the electrical pattern. That's not in this model. No.
But thank you. Very nice overview, as always. I was wondering a little bit, when you looked at the dog experiments and then comparing the model with the experiments, when you change the AV delay, the model is not working. Do you have any idea why?
The model is actually showing more effect than what we see in the animals. And so you see here that this is a very strong effect of AV delay in the model, whereas in the experiments we see something, but it's definitely quantitatively off.
Do you know the difference?
No. I mean, we have to play around maybe with filling status and things like that.
Yeah. Because I indeed, in a normal heart rate range, I wouldn't expect a huge difference as you see in the animals. But it's curious that the model gives it.
We have another study which we hope to submit soon, where we do see, under different conditions, a better fit. But that depends really on specific settings in the model. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for the talk. I would like to know your opinion about new pacing strategies like his bundle pacing that during the last year or so, it looked like amazing new thing, that it was always going to be better than CRT pacing, but at HRS, the first kind of randomized clinical trial showed that there were no difference with respect to CRT. And I wonder, is, as always, I mean, patient selection would be so important to also decide between one patient strategy or another.
Yeah. So the point, and for people not into the field immediately, over the last few years, and even the last Congress, it was a lot emphasized, is showing data that if you pace here on the His bundle, this would be better, or at least as good as biventricular pacing. Now, initially, this is weird, because if we say we have a left bundle branch block, the block is here, and it wouldn't make sense to pace there, because you still have the block. Interestingly, so what this shows, and we have our own experience in patients as well, it shows that what we call left bundle branch block is actually not, at least not only at that point, but also more proximal in or near the AV node. So that's interesting on of its own. But I think what the data show also in this study, you don't get a perfectly narrow QRS in most of these CRT patients. You get a reduction, and QRS duration is 150, 160, you go back to 130, 140, so it's still good, but you never go, or almost never go, 200. And probably because there's also some block along the line. But it's very fascinating about this work. Personally, I think it's very intriguing, but it's also complicated because you have to be very precise in positioning that lead. We have another approach, but that's now too far to address. And people are also talking now pacing the left bundle branch, so it would be like here, but the drawing here is not so good, but somewhere up in the septum address, so going here more or less, this has to be proven how easy and how consistent it is, and also like with pacing thresholds, you need more electrical stimulus to be able to capture the myocardium, so you lose more battery. It's fascinating, certainly for a researcher like me, but I'm not convinced this is going to be good for every patient and for every cardiologist, as we say, in a peripheral center who just wants to be back at home at 5 o'clock.
Great.
Marco.
I think it's time to wellness.
Question regarding the total work that you measured, or not measured, calculated. So was it a mechanical work, or was it a stress strain area?
What's the difference?
Well, the stress strain area includes also the potential energy, right? So it will be then related to the energy consumption of the...
I think it's only the external work, if I'm not mistaken.
All right, that was a quick one. We're going to thank again the speaker and get ready for the next one. Thanks, Fritz.